Hi all, I am Panos. I'm standing because of the aerobic. I am in Zurich. Here it's 1:30. I'm in a self-organized space in the center of the city. I hear some voices around from drunken people. The space is very central in one of the major streets in the city. And if you see the slide, this is the photo of the room on the other side from the one that you see me. And I have here the same setup. Yesterday we had a hybrid event, as we call it. The idea is here in the space we have installed some infrastructure to be able to create a teleconference, Zoom, Blue Button, whatever platform everybody wants, to do it in groups. I guess one of the biggest problems of this type of online meetings is the loneliness of our rooms. So we try here in the space to bring people to connect online together. And so I'm here. And I will talk a little bit about this idea of hybrid space. And I'm Panagiotis or Panos Antoniadis. The title of my talk is Federation of Hybrid Spaces. And the project that I presented before, it's a project that it's for with the Internet Society. Our space is called L200, and my organization is NetHood. So, I will introduce a little bit my background. Since many years, I am one of the advocates and very passionate people about this local offline, we were calling them local first. I don't know, there are different names, networks, like one of the first of the type of the Occupy here. Perhaps many of you know the Pirate Box. If people don't know about these things, it's good to know if people are not familiar with these offline networks. So, yes, there are many variations, many presentations and brandings, let's say, of these local Wi-Fi networks that could be connected or disconnected from the internet. These are more artistic versions from Berlin. This is one of the known projects, now I forget the name. Just to give you some impressions of where I come from, I was always thinking of how we can make such local networks more attractive, more interesting, how to frame them. This was from a summer school where we created a local network on a chair, so people could make selfies and record their photos practically on the chair, which was inspired by a project from the past, the yellow chair, that people were putting out of their houses when they were sharing Wi-Fi at the time that there was no smartphones. This is another project from Dania with a super glue. I was also involved in a project that we tried all these local networks to make them more easy to manage. One could imagine something like a WordPress for local networks. This was the Mazi project, and we created a toolkit, the Mazi toolkit, that one can put it on a SD card on a Raspberry Pi and easily decide what type of services this local network could offer. And the idea was to make it more accessible. Technically speaking, you can imagine it as a Uno host and Nodedocs Plus together with a web user interface. And for example, we use this toolkit with the green piece here in Zurich to create an action in the airport where we somehow hacked the Wi-Fi of the airport, and people, when they were connecting, they were thinking that they were connecting to the airport Wi-Fi. This local network was capturing the connection and was showing a video that you could fly less, for example. The thing with these networks, no matter how much I tried to people that were not technical to tell them how interesting they are, it was not really easy to engage people in this. I mean, they require some effort, and one could see them a little bit in the positive side as seed bombs, as some sort of provocations that we can put in the space and inspire people of the idea that they could plant their own networks. And all this thinking and how to pass the message to people of why such networks are interesting, I tried to build on this analogy with food. And I was talking a lot on the idea of comparing with food. And when we talk about food, people really understand the difference between industrial agriculture and organic agriculture. But I'm not sure if all the people understand that the internet that we use today is almost 100% industrial. I mean, they don't get this comparison. And I think it's very important to create images for people to understand the unhealthiness, let's say, of the industrial internet. And this is a popular image, a comparison that I try to do with Monsanto and Facebook. And yes, it's not on the slide, but the message here is that as Monsanto feeds us with genetically modified organisms, Facebook offers us algorithmically modified data. This is something that I try to promote as a term, algorithmically modified data. And perhaps one day it would be obligatory on Facebook to write that it contains the AMDs. So the question is about what could be the organic internet. And building a little bit on the analogy, we could imagine all the open source software things as a tree. And on the bottom of this tree, we have all these community networks. I wear the Freifunk t-shirt. Perhaps you know these more large-scale self-organized infrastructures. And on top, you could have platforms that help people to collaborate, to make decisions, etc. What is very important, and this is what I want to say today, is that this is not enough. We need also people to talk and to meet in real spaces. And this is the argument I try to make. It's not enough to have self-hosted Mastodon servers, Nextcloud, Etherpad, and host them in remote servers managed from people that we don't know. We need people to get closer to their digital platforms and meet in person. So this is somehow the image that I would like to pass, the idea that we have already many physical spaces in the city that are like-minded, that try to promote values of cooperation. On the left, you see a cooperative housing project in Zurich. On the right is Prinzessinnen Garden in Berlin. These are very active and progressive spaces. And then we can imagine that such spaces could have their own digital infrastructures that we could really plant them there, like trees, and grow them together with the people that are around. Exactly in the same way that we install a Nextcloud instance on a specific server, we can imagine that this server is not a virtual server somewhere, but it really resides in a specific place. And then we can imagine the federation. I mean, if all these things are created and they are robust, we can imagine networks like GWIFI or Sardex is a community currency network from Sardinia. So this is somehow the vision. It's not difficult. So as Nethood, the organization that I have founded and I'm working since many years, we try to create some sort of a holistic perspective on solving this problem of designing hybrid space. It's not only about technology, it's about communities, about housing, about food, and how we can bring all these things together. And where I am now, it's a space in Zurich, we call it L200. And it's very central, and this is one of its key characteristics. We see the space also like an infrastructure, as we, in the digital domain, we want to claim the digital infrastructure, to own it and manage it as communities. We see the same such a space. And the motto in German is that it's auch dein Raum, so it's also your space. A subtle difference with other self-organized spaces is that we try very, very hard not to dictate the type of usages. We don't exclude, for example, commercial usages, but we limit them. The idea is to see the space as an infrastructure that everybody contributes to maintain. The rent here is very high. We don't squat. We don't demand the subsidies. We pay the market rent all together, all the organizations that are here. And then after we have managed to secure the space, we have a very simple first come, first serve rule, and everybody can use the space as really as they want. And the more diverse the usages, the more the point we make. And our joke is that everybody that enters asks, what is this? And this is some sort of a success that people don't really understand what it is, so they can use the space as they imagine. So I have put some photos of diverse usages from, these are all pro-corona, because now we cannot do such crowded events. Just to give you an impression of what happens in this small space, from panels to art events. Because it's very central, many organizations and groups here use it as an info point. Because it's we try to combine things, so pickup station for from farmers close by, to participatory workshops all happening together. We try to create this sense of diversity and interaction. And yes, it's visible for the street, so we see it as some sort of a signpost, a space that it's not on the back. So we want to bring all these discussions also about technology really in the center of the city. This is my project, for example. Many people don't even know what I'm doing here with the Raspberry Pis. This was a small experiment with this the Mazi toolkit with an Etherpad. I put a screen on the window. It's a little confusing, the image. So we put a screen on the window and people could use it as a board, for example. Everybody here can use the space in different moments to do different things. So this was an example of using it as a local network that people can interact only on when they are here. And this is from the event yesterday. This is the slide that I started. And this is, for me, very interesting. And this is some sort of a proposal or, I don't know, a suggestion that I would like to make in this forum, to imagine such spaces as we imagine different servers installed all over the world. We can imagine them installed in spaces. And now that we get more and more used in this type of digital communication with Big Blue Button and all these platforms, to start interacting between us, not through our bedrooms, but through these spaces. So it's more difficult than it sounds. It leads a lot of, it's like having a TV studio. But now with all these cheaper tools and recycling cameras and microphones, I think it's not so hard to create a good quality and video connection for multiple people from one space, that they connect to another space on the other side of the world. Of course, the time zone is a problem. When I first submitted my proposal to talk here, I proposed to do a workshop between spaces, and I was hoping to find a space perhaps in Toronto where we can bring people. Then at that time I didn't realize that here it would be 1:30, but maybe it could be a more easy time zone anyway. So yes, The idea is to start bringing the questions of technology to the ground and have people that walk on the street to be able to get information and contact about alternative digital tools and communicate with other spaces that are like-minded and build some sort of a community around these things. This is another, so we tried different things. Yesterday, we tried to have an online meeting on Big Blue Button, where the whole room was participating in the online meeting. And we even had this microphone that I have here as the online space of the physical room. People should go to the microphone to enter in the Big Blue Button, let's say, area. While some months ago, we did completely the opposite. We created a round table in the space and it was streamed on Big Blue Button, and then we were more together. It was at the time of the quarantine. People were missing a lot each other, and we thought, let's do an online meeting where we talk physically between each other. So we experiment with different formats, and whoever has access to such alternative community spaces, we are trying to create some sort of a network of spaces where we can try different technical solutions, we can inspire each other, we can encourage each other. And all this is part of, because as I said before about the analogies, and I think it's very important to create more mainstream messages and more accessible. So these events that I mentioned are part of a series that we call 7 at 7. And the idea is to create a very memorable moment, as the news, for example, the news at 7 o'clock, that people know that they will open the TV and they will see the news. The idea is that on the 7th of the month at 7 p.m., we cannot do it every day, every month, people can tune on the permanent digital address of L200. For this specific event, it's even more specific. It's 7at7.digital, and it's always a Big Blue Button room that you enter, or come here, and they will learn something. So we start slowly, slowly, trying to be a little bit more performative and more quality content, to attract really people that are not like-minded. For me, this is always my concern when I mean, these circles of hackers, of technologists that that know how things work and they promote alternative solutions. But let's say what we call the normal people are always see them very far. So all these type of analogies with organic internet, the space in the center of the city, the memorable regular series of learning and communication about, we call it here, digital self-defense. I think there are all important elements to be able to make these community networks and our networks a little bit, I mean, this hour to be a little bit bigger. So it's difficult here alone. I don't hear also anything. My eyes catch a little bit the stream on the left. Was it, how can I say? Did you understand what I want to say? Is it interesting? I don't know. I can sing while you are thinking to ask a question, or I can elaborate on something. Don, what do you think? Should I skip talking? I don't know if I have another slide. Yeah, I guess these are some articles I had written some time ago. These are old slides, yes. About the organic internet. This is a term that I really think it's it can catch a little bit the imagination of people. What I say often is that for organic agriculture, we have a memory of how it was in the past. We say in Greece that tomatoes were smelling like tomatoes, and now they don't smell like tomatoes. We have the idea of how good is the organic. While in the internet, most of the people were born into a world that there was no organic. They ate directly from the supermarket with the GMOs from the very first moment. So we don't have this imagination. And if we build on this analogy, because people get it for the food, there is a hope that they might get it also for the internet.
I'm just going to jump in now.
I can keep talking. I mean, I am good at talking.
I am just going to jump in now if you can hear me.
I hear you, yes.
Great. There was one question. Okay, I asked it in the chat that I'll re-ask if you'd like to, if you could answer. And then I would encourage other folks, we have some time for questions, to please share them. I'll be monitoring the chat too, and I can repeat them over stream.
See, it was a little long and I couldn't read it.
Yeah, sure. No worries. I'm too verbose. So the question I had, actually, you kind of brought it up in 2 points, so maybe you can expand. Sort of thinking about mutual aid work and groups that are starting up, or those kinds of volunteering muscles that have happened maybe post coronavirus. And mm-hmm. The question was, I've been involved with some folks and projects here in Toronto. There's lots of virtual meetings and developing networks that is happening quickly. How to knit some of these practices with those digital alternatives rather than relying on the major tools. And you use the phrase below or later in your talk about how to extend the R of our network. So I wonder if you could say more.
Yes, I mean, what it's very important is that these alternative tools are not ready for big scales somehow. No, I mean, I know people that are very into alternative, but if they have big meetings, they use Zoom just to be sure, for example. For me, it's really, really important to do all these alternatives in spaces. I mean, we are too much on our computers, we are too much isolated, and too much in bubbles, in a sense, because we find very easily those that are like-minded and we advance our thinking. For me, it's really important to have very well-defined spaces in the city that such tools, for example, are used, and so people can try them. So, for example, we did this event here. People entered and they could see the big blue button that we were using to communicate on the screen, and they could see how it works. If I would send them an email, please use this tool, etc., maybe they wouldn't bother. I think it's very important to create really spaces, physical, that all these alternative tools are there, ready to show, and then the scales are smaller and they can work very well. I mean, if you have a virtual meeting with 30 people, you need 30, I don't know how many connections to be able to talk all together. But if these 30 people are divided in 5 spaces that have the right infrastructure to connect, you need 5. I don't know the maths now, connections between the 5 spaces. So yes, I think we should decrease the scale and invest a lot on local communities. Another thing I wanted to discuss here, but I didn't organize it well, was all this sidewalks lab story, no? And this imagination of the smart city that understands the citizens and gives solutions. And before it stopped, I'm curious actually to know what is happening now. I had this idea that somebody could promote an alternative to the sidewalk lab, some sort of a resilience lab, and have collaborations between food projects, urban gardens, and digital communities all together to propose an alternative that it's more holistic. It's not just the server or the software, but it's also the garden that hosts it. And using recycled hardware and being a little bit slower, you know, a little bit the idea of the growth, not to try to compete. So yes, I don't know if I answered your questions, but I think we should go to the right scale to use such alternative tools and integrate them in a wider concept around sustainability, ecology. Yeah, this is my...
I see some people typing.
Did I answer? I don't hear you.
Yeah, no, it was great. I was just going to say I see some people typing, so I'm going to maybe give a moment and see if anyone here. Someone has added a comment, and maybe you could respond to this, and this might be our last question. This idea of doing work in physical spaces sounds similar to a discotheque, and the link is to Detroit Community Technology Project. And I believe it's their zine on discotheques or discovering technology fairs. How do we organize this type of work right now when physical gathering is more precarious and limited?
Yes, I mean, this is a good question, but it's more precarious, but it's always needed. And I think technology actually can help us to meet without crowd ourselves. So this is the idea that we try to develop here in our space. For people to be able to meet in bigger numbers, but not being all in the same space. So this is a nice use of technology, no? Okay, we need technology now to connect because we cannot crowd. Okay, but let's connect with other humans around us in the right distance. I mean, we can be in 2 meters away between each other, in the same room and interconnect with others. I think this is actually a good moment to promote such things because now digitalization seems inevitable. So I think we should provide some sort of solutions that are not so dehumanizing and create this type of packages that are attractive also because people need the human contact. I don't know if you have heard about the Zoom fatigue, if you feel it. Myself, I cannot stand these Zoom meetings anymore. I want to have people next to me. And yes, I think we don't know how all this situation will evolve, but personally, I find it as an opportunity that we need more space, more spaces, and we need to interconnect them. This would be my answer.
Great, thank you so much. I think we want to give ourselves a couple minutes to switch over to the next talk. So I don't know how this works when you don't get to hear a round of applause, but I would encourage people to leave twinkles or sparkles or hand claps or however you want to say thank you to Panos for the talk, and I'll just do some twinkles here. It was great.
Thank you very much, yes. It's a strange experience to talk to the screen, and the worst with these things is when you close and you stay alone in your room, quiet. I think this is a very interesting feeling. It might have some name in the future, this silence after the Zoom, I don't know.
If we might coin it after at this conference.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you for listening, and yes, let's connect our spaces.